to Studio 5. Here's the news many of us have already discovered in life. It is not always easy to have a happy, healthy relationship.
It's not, and it doesn't matter if it's a spouse or a co-worker, maybe a neighbor or a friend. Sometimes you just really have to work at making your relationships healthy.
Now, the problem is, you see movies. You know, movies make it all look so happy or whatever. They make it look so simple. This summer, the movie Mamma Mia, did you see that one?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they have you believing that relationships are as easy as just like a fun romp on the beach. But in real life, we don't have some backup course coming up out of the surf just on cue. And making a healthy relationship is really more than just dancing around some island all day long.
I think it is, at least, right? This month, we're trying to be healthy, and one of the most important aspects of your health is your relationships.
Whether you are married, whether you're single, we all have relationships. And Studio 5's relationship coach, Matt Townsend, wants to make sure that those relationships really are healthy. You've worked with countless relationships and couples. What is the key? What does it mean to have a healthy relationship?
I think part of the key to a healthy relationship is one that you can get results today without killing your ability to get results tomorrow. Yeah. Anybody can get a result in a relationship today. That's why anybody could pick someone up on one date and go have a party. The key is, can you have a good relationship long term? In a long term enduring relationship, the best way to see how to do it is to check out those people that have done it. Look at the people out there that are having healthy, long-term relationships, and you're going to clue into a lot of the keys to success there.
And you've done just that for us today. We've clued into five relationships. We're going to tap into a quality of each of those relationships that attributes to a healthy relationship.
Exactly. And the hardest thing about this is no relationship's perfect, and we don't have all the data about all of these couples that we're going to talk about, but I just want to talk about five specific what I believe are truths, principles that I think lead to effective, healthy relationships. And we're going to try to point out a few examples, maybe in the spotlight, the media, the people out there that have proved it.
Okay, your first one, your first quality is reciprocity, which we had to look up in the dictionary. So it's like a give and take, helping people.
That's
you've chosen someone you think illustrates that.
Okay, well, I've chosen Mitt and Ann Romney. Okay, reciprocity is the idea that in a long-term relationship, if you want it to work, two people have to be benefiting mutually. And it can't just be one way. The relationship can't be just about Mitt's career, and it can't only be just about Ann's career. What it is it's a balance of taking, or Ann's health. Remember, the big issue with Mitt and Ann is Ann was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, and it became a really big part of their life. And some of the things that were interesting for me about reciprocity is Ann fully supported Mitt's career, his desire to become president, and simultaneously Mitt was supportive and doing everything he could to make sure Ann's health was okay. He you know, she started horseback riding. In an interview he did with George Stephanopoulos, the biggest, most proud moment of the entire interview was when he was talking about how Ann was the amateur equestrian champion of the nation. And so here's a guy running for president talking about his wife's a professional, an amateur horseback rider. And so there was this reciprocity. If you want a relationship to last long term, both people have to be benefiting, both people have to be cared about and promoted and pushed.
Is that just a constant self-check then in a relationship to make sure you're thinking and cluing into the other person's successes and accomplishments?
Absolutely. And being willing to start actually not just noticing them, but actually making it something you celebrate. All of a sudden, when Mitt's celebrating Ann's health and Ann's successes, it gives Ann energy to celebrate Mitt's health and Mitt's successes.
You know, it's sort of like that rule you hear when you're first dating. You say, hey, talk about the other person. Always direct it toward them and it'll be good.
Turn it back.
But once you had a relationship for a while, you think you sort of grow old and you don't...
That's right.
You don't exactly.
Reciprocity's always been a part of dating. You invite her, she sends you a note. You call her because the nose.
Yes or no.
It's exactly.
Hey,
yeah, we're not in sixth grade. Gravity.
Well, you said a little no. And I was like, are we in the 2009s or what?
I'm always bringing you back in by giving you something.
Okay. The next quality on your list of healthy relationships is mutual purpose.
Mutual purpose. If you want a relationship to last a long time, you've got to both be bought into the same purpose. In the last year, we've probably not seen a couple with more of a shared purpose than Michelle and Barack Obama. How do you go through what they have to go through if you do not have the same goals? And if you ever saw him on stage, you could tell, or if you ever saw Michelle talking about Barack, she totally believed in his purpose. She believed in his talents and his skills. And so he's the same thing. He knows she's talented, and he knows that if for reciprocity's sake, she's giving up some of the professional limelight right now to be with her family, and she's supportive. So part of this is about, if you want something to work long term, you both got to buy into the same vision. Have you ever heard the quote, people without vision perish? Couples without purpose perish. You have to have a united common goal or a united set of beliefs if you want the relationship to last. Or otherwise, two purposes will eventually become divided.
And their purpose is so unified, it's one. Like you talked about. I mean, her purpose is his purpose, his purpose, her purpose. It's very strong.
And there, I bet you if we really got into it, he would be able to put some of the presidency aside for the purpose that's even higher for them, their family, their kids. Mm-hmm. There's going to be times, I bet you bucks, he won't be in the Oval Office. He'll be up playing with his kids.
Yeah. You know, if we were going through this, and I was thinking about, like, the relationship that Brooke and I have on the show, I think that is one of the key things, that we both have this mutual purpose. We love Studio 5. We love what the show is about. We love our viewers. I think that's one of the things that helps us in that relationship.
It's a universal truth. So it's with all relationships. You want somebody to be around a long time, they got to buy into your vision, and they got to benefit.
Okay. Number three, you've chosen the quality of trust.
Trust. Now, to me, trust is the foundation of all relationships, because everything is bound on trust. How do you communicate with someone you don't trust? The model I wanted to play out here was President Gordon B. Hinckley and his wife Marjorie Hinckley. President Hinckley is the president of the LDS Church, passed away a little while ago. And his wife Marjorie, he and Marjorie had an incredible relationship from what I've read, and I know people that know him. And one of the interesting things about him, trust is a powerful thing, because the more trust I have with somebody, the more latitude they give me. Okay, the more freedom I have. So if I'm a real trustworthy guy, my wife's okay with me maybe coming home late once in a while, because she knows I'm a trustworthy guy with character. She also knows I have no life and nowhere else to go.
But nothing to worry about there.
President Hinckley is notorious and famous for some stories about, you know, he had to travel all over the world. Some nights he'd come home and he'd be needing to leave to go somewhere tomorrow, and Marjorie wouldn't know if she's going with him or not. And she'd say, "So, Gordon, am I going with you?" And he's like, "Ah, we don't need to decide that right now."
About that suitcase.
That's right. And she would literally, she was okay with the idea that, you know what, I trust him. If he needs me there, he'll ask me to be there. He won't ask me to be there if I don't need to be there. So I'm here when you need me. Now, that also, she was real patient with him, because a lot of women wouldn't take that from their partner. By the way, when he would come home, here he is, the leader of the LDS Church. When he'd come home, he'd want to lead his family. And he'd start taking charge and start pushing her aside. And she said, "No, no, no, Gordon, you need to step back." And because he trusted her, he would allow her to take her place. Trust is the key to all long-term relationships. It's literally the grease that starts the slide going.
And it applies, as you point out, to the big issues and the small issues.
Exactly.
As big as, you know, a trip around the world and as small as a night home with the family.
Everything comes down to trust. In my coaching, all relationship issues come down to trust. How much do you trust me for what I'm about to say to you? Or do you trust me enough to believe me?
Are you asking me?
No. absolutely not.
We got two more we got to get through quickly here. Number four is growth. And you've selected a couple that most people aren't going to know.
Oh, no, but they're famous in my world. This is, growth is about commitment and mutual development. This is my grandfather-in-law and grandmother-in-law, Margaret and Bill Priest, and my daughter Sarah waving. She was a smart kid. She knew when to wave. But one of the things about these, this was a couple, pretty average, typical couple, loved each other for a long time. Eventually, though, what I learned is growth doesn't end in a relationship even when our partners no longer are capable of being loving. My grandmother-in-law, Margaret, had Alzheimer's, and Bill got the opportunity to serve Margaret every single day while she had Alzheimer's. He fed her, he cooked for her, he fluffed up her hair with his big hands. He took care of this woman. And eventually she passed away. And when she passed away, Bill sat the entire family down, and this is what he said. He said, "I learned more about love in the last few years of Margaret's life, and I learned to love her more than I had learned my entire life with Margaret." He then taught us all a very important growth lesson. Don't wait till someone's dying to earn that most enduring love. Earn it every day right now. Serve your partner like I served Margaret, and you'll grow. And you'll grow in love as you go. Growth and development and learning is key to a relationship. Most of us are okay with a partner that's a little slow, as long as they're growing.
Yeah.
If they're slow and no longer growing, if they're inattentive and not learning, we start to feel hopeless.
So growth. Those baby steps.
Mm-hmm. That can make tiny little bitty things.
Okay, your final one is a quality I really admire, understanding, and a powerful story here to illustrate.
Last but not least, and this is an interesting one, because this isn't a couple. This is a man, but I think he was living out the will of a couple. There's a guy named Chris Williams right here. You can see him on the screen. And Chris Williams was a man in Salt Lake City, and the first boy that you saw was a drunk driving teenager teenager that crashed into Chris Williams and his wife that was pregnant and killed his wife that was pregnant and two of their children. And immediately Chris Williams, the principal's understanding, understood the importance of forgiving this boy. And he forgave the boy so that he could heal his family, Chris Williams said, and Cameron Wright's family, the boy that had killed his family. He now, and you can see right here the video we're watching, well, the video we were watching was Mary Kay Huntsman put together an anti-drunk driving campaign where they involved Chris Williams and the White family, the parents of Cameron White and Cameron White, and they're all now trying to create understanding from what they've learned. They want to share understanding with the rest of the state that you don't drink and drive.
It's an incredible, every time I hear that story, I just get goosebumps.
And you got to listen to the story. Go to KSL.com and look up Chris Williams, because it's one of the most profound stories about understanding. And if Chris Williams can do that with a person that's hurt him so deeply, how come we couldn't do that with our wife who burned the turkey, or with our husband who doesn't pick up his stuff?
Yeah. I mean, that's a big one to forget about, understanding, and that's an example for us all to go through.
We can all do it.
Great tips. Matt has, of course, those five. He's also got this great thing that's called Matt's Date Night, and he's got one coming up just this Saturday, right?
Saturday, January 17th from 7 to 8:30. It's a date night where you come sit down. I spend an hour and a half teaching the differences between men and women. Tons of fun. Bring your partner. It's a great way. If you know you need a little help, it's a great way to get your partner introduced to getting some help. We also, but if you want to do it, you got to call us. It's 747-2121 and get on our list. It's filling up. We have another one coming up in February, on February 21st.
Okay, free admission, but you do have to register ahead of time. So that information to do so is on our website for you, studio5.ksl.com. Powerful lessons, Matt. Thanks so much.
Appreciate it.
All right, next on Studio 5, Soup's On. And this version of French Onion is much more...